Okay, let's talk about alkene allylic bromination with NBS. So N-bromosuccinimide in the presence of a radical initiator. So you might see a good reaction for this is to brominate this allylic position, so next door to a double bond, and we would show the reaction, line reaction, and conditions as having this reagent NBS, and then a peroxide initiator. A little heat can cause benzoyl peroxide to initiate. So here's a common initiator that you might see, benzoyl peroxide, low 50 degrees Celsius. You get that to initiate the radicals, very stable because of the increased resonance. So something to get your reaction going. You will form this single bromination product because of the symmetry of this alkene here. And we'll look at that in just a moment. Okay, so a good reaction partner for this is propene. Now, the keys to synthesis with NBS and the alkene is to use on a highly symmetrical alkene that only have one type of alpha hydrogen next door in this allylic position. So there we go, two allylic positions that form mirror image resonance contributors that are the same. So you see this high degree of symmetry in this alkene. If we deprotonate, or excuse me, abstract the hydrogen in the first step, propagation step of that mechanism, and you get this allylic radical, we can check that we get equivalent contributors, mirror images of one another, that will give us the same bromination product if we then add the bromine molecule to this allylic radical. And so no matter which way we substitute, whether at this position or this position, you're going to get the exact same 1, 2, and 3 bromo cyclohexene product. So a good candidate there for allylic bromination. The other way is if we have a clear winner, so a clear most stable allylic radical, and we have to check. This is workable and can be accepted on the exam, but we've got to check. So we've got two allylic positions here that are different. Here's one and here's one. So one's got a methyl group attached. Okay, and so if we say what if, well, what if we take the abstracted proton from the tertiary position here, well, then resonance for radicals would dictate meet in the middle, one radical left over, so the radical skips an atom, and we form a new pi bond as those radicals come together there. We leave that radical on the other side. Well, let's compare to the what if. This is an either or here. If we have a good situation, it'll be a clear winner. What if we'd taken that proton from the bottom allylic position? Well, if we had, resonance would then dictate that we'd form a second character to this resonance hybrid, where our pi bond forms here, and we form a primary allylic at the top. So if we look at these, we've got a tertiary allylic, we've got a primary allylic, then we've got a secondary allylic, and a primary allylic. So the most stable overall resonance form, the most stable radical overall, is going to come from the structure we have at the top left here. And so overall, we would expect a bit of an excess of bromination at the more substituted radical here. And so this could be workable, but you're going to have four total products. Okay, so the more allylic position the more allylic positions you add and the more resonance forms that you have that are different from one another, you get more products in the mixture and you limit the usefulness of this reaction. So typically you want to use this early in a synthesis if you are going to use it. And if we've got a situation where we have more allylic positions and no symmetry and no clear winner, we really don't work that well, because here we've got one and two allylic positions, could even have more if I'd substituted the alkene more. But look at this. So if we abstract that left hand allylic position and we resonate, we end up with a radical with secondary nature here on both. So we have a secondary and a secondary. And then here, if we again abstract the proton from the right hand side and we resonate, either or, both are happening to different degrees though. Can't abstract both from the same molecule at the same time. And we do the resonance here, just trying to see if one's better than the other. We end up with a radical here, and again we've got secondary and secondary. So it turns out that these two structures at the top are identical to one another. So this one and this one give us the same radical overall. But then we get two different radicals from the bottom. Okay, the double bond placement is now different on these, and the radical placement is different. Okay, here if we're counting at the top, we are 1, 2, 3 from the radical, 4 to the double bond, 1, 2, 3 to the radical, 4 to the double bond, so that's the same. But here we're 1, 2 to the radical, 3 to the double bond, 1, 2, 3, 4 to the radical, 5 to the double bond. So just trying to make sure we have different molecules. We do. We have three different structures, even though two of them are the same. They're all secondary, so we'd expect a big mixture of products here. And so there's not really a clear winner that we can go with more than 50% in this reaction. We might get up to 50% here, but not really a clear most stable winner, so I would not like to use this one as proposed in a synthesis if we can help it. Okay, so not the best, doesn't work as well. Now looking at the mechanism, initiation is begun by homolytic cleavage of that peroxide. So any old peroxide will do. We use benzoyl peroxide as our example structure, something that's often used. And then we form two radicals from none, two oxygen radicals here. Propagation then begins with homolytic cleavage of NBS. Couldn't find a great reference for exactly how this goes, so I'm going to go with our NBS structure here, what most likely happens is that we free up a bromine radical by forming a bond between nitrogen and oxygen and then freeing up that bromine radical here. It is well known that the bromine radical is what participates in the next propagation step that we have. And so we then have that nitrogen-oxygen connected. Again, not the clearest information on that byproduct, but it is fairly clear that this is required to get the rest of this process going. So we generate that bromine radical here. Our next propagation step is to take our, let's just say this alkene, we'll use this as our example reaction, and abstract the allylic position. It is possible to abstract or to attach the bromine to the double bond. However, the concentration of HBr that is produced in this step is held very low by a reaction we're going to look at in a moment. The main part of this step, or the main purpose of this step, is to generate this allylic radical. Okay, so there's that HBr, and we know that bromine radicals can react with double bonds. The reason it doesn't is because in the next step, this HBr is consumed in a side reaction with more NBS. This is an ionic exchange that produces Br2 and succinimid, the amide form here. Okay, so now we've generated Br2 and we've consumed HBr, so that it cannot and no longer be available to add to our double bond. All right, that's important here. That's an aside, that's not part of the propagation step, but that does occur at this point to send us down the pathway of allylic bromination. And so once we've got that allylic radical, it will then react with the bromine molecule in a third propagation step here to add our bromine. And then generate another bromine radical that can then abstract an allylic proton and continue the mechanism, so forth and so on. Okay, it is not necessary to show a termination step for this process, but if you were, two bromine radicals coming together would terminate the process, but they are not descriptive of product formation. So if you did want to show termination, you could do that as a way out here. But any two radicals in the solution becoming none and a neutral molecule is an appropriate termination step. So keys to remember, the HBr is consumed before it can react with the alkene. Just like in the anti-Markovnikov halogenation radical mechanism, and then Br2 being produced only after the allylic radical is formed prevents addition to that double bond like we saw back in an earlier chapter in alkene reactions as well. All right.